Hey guys, welcome back to Jessen Reads Romance. I'm Jessen, and today is another weekly wrap-up, the 1st of February. And I had a very interesting reading week. You'll see what I mean whenever I start talking about the books and how I selected the books that I was going to read this week, because there's two readathons going on that I'm participating in. I'm not really following the prompts for the readathon. Sometimes I'll do this. For readathons, usually they have this bingo card and you can follow the prompts to select your books. But sometimes I don't follow them because I try to just select books that I already own on my Kindle or physical copy to just like fit in with the overall theme. So I'm doing the Fantasy Romance February readathon, and I'm also doing the Black Author readathon as well, casually, just like picking up whatever I have on my hands and reading them. So I have a lot of options, and sometimes that doesn't help me select the next book, and sometimes I get in weird moods where I'll open like a couple books, read the first chapter, and be like, I'm not really feeling this. So that was that this type of weekend. That's what happened. But anyway, let's get started. Let's start talking about the books that I read. So over the course of the weekend, I read The Heiress Hunt by Joanna Shupe, and I also read The Devil in Her Bed. That wasn't included in last week's reading weekly wrap-up, but I did do a vlog on reading those arcs, so I'll link that down below if you want to know my like full thoughts on all the arcs that I read last week and last Sunday, this past Sunday. So I had those two, and then I started Radiance, which Radiance has been on my TBR for a long time. Juliet, my fellow podcast co-host and also my aunt, really loved Grace Draven, and she's like, you really need to read Radiance, and she has so many cool covers, and I'm like, yes, anyway. So I bought a lot of her books, and I still hadn't read them. So when the Fantasy Romance February readathon kicked off and was announced, I was like, oh, this is perfect. I'll stick Radiance on there. So I did get the opportunity to read Radiance, and I'm really glad that I did. So this is like light fantasy. It's not very heavy with the world building. I would say if you are unfamiliar with fantasy, this would probably be a good place to start with it, because it's not too complicated. I wouldn't say the world building is too complicated, and actually has a very slow start. So if you've never read fantasy before, it probably won't be confusing for you. Personally, I wish that it had a little bit of a faster pace, because I did feel like we were dragging on in the beginning. But I overall like this book. I rated this 4 stars. This is the first book in her Wraith Kings series, and a lot of interesting things happen at the very end of this book, and so I really want to read the next book, Eidolon. But let me tell you about the characters, and I don't know if I'm pronouncing their names correctly, so bear with me if I'm pronouncing them wrong. But our heroine is Ildiko, and she is human. And there is a fae race in this world, but the humans have their own kingdoms. They kind of like really don't interfere with each other, but they also, the fairies, the fae, aren't really secretive either. So the hero is Brishan, and he is part of a fae race. And what happens is there's kind of like an arranged marriage. It's not like they were at war or fighting. It's just kind of be like, hey, this is like a show of good faith. How about we have, you know, a person of the royal bloodline marry a person of your royal bloodline. So Brishan is the second son. He's the spare, like a lot of times over, because his older brother has a lot of kids. And Ildiko is like the niece of the king of one of the human kingdoms. And so they're the ones, the lucky winners, that get to have an arranged marriage. Interestingly, in this story, the fae are very ugly to the humans. You can see in this cover that he has gray skin and claws. Where's his hand? Yes, right here. It's hard to see in the camera, but his hand is right here, and he has gray claws. Anyway, so, and the fae think that humans are very ugly. They think that they're pale and colorless and just like gross looking. And the fae race, this fae race is nocturnal as well. They have like no whites in their eyes. It's all just black, and they find humans' eyes very unsettling. So it's kind of like a shtick of the story, because Brishan and Ildiko meet in the gardens, and they have a conversation, not knowing who the other is. They don't know that this is the person that they're about to marry. And they have a very honest and frank conversation, because Ildiko is, I'm just gonna call her Iko, because I hate saying that full name. It's like, I know I'm not pronouncing it right. So Iko is kind of like, how does the prince feel about marrying me? Like, I know you guys think we're ugly. And he was like, true, like, you aren't pretty. Like, I don't think you're pretty. And she's like, yeah, I think you're monstrous. you look like a monster. If you would have popped out, you know, at night, you would have been a person of my nightmares. And so their relationship gets off to a pretty good start because there's a lot of honesty right up front. When he figures out that, oh, this is my intended, they are like, oh, wow. So we already have a rapport. We can be friends. We can totally do this. And so I really like that they start off their marriage as really good friends. Also, both of them like to bring up how ugly the other is. Like, it's kind of like a joke between them. It's not being mean or anything. But I was kind of like, okay, this is going to be a romance, right? Y'all are going to have to get over that you find the human race ugly and she finds your race ugly. You're going to have to be attracted to each other at some time. So that's one part of the story that I wish Grace Draven would have pulled back on, because eventually there is a change of heart and it's like, well, you're beautiful to me. And I'm like, I don't know. I wasn't turned off by his illustration right here. I was like, he looks pretty hot. So I don't know what her problem is. And I guess that was a me thing reading. I'm just like, girl, he's hot. He's nice. Y'all like best friends. And I'd be all up on that. I don't know what your problem is. So it is a very slow burn. They don't get together until much later in the story, like as lovers, as husband and wife. They don't sleep together for a very long time. And it's very gradual. But Brishan's family has a very interesting dynamic. His father is the king, but it's his mother who's the really dangerous party. She is horrible. She is baiting Aiko like at every chance that she gets. The ending of this really feels like it's kicking off the world. There's a lot of like interesting side characters as well. And yeah, 4 stars for this book. Then I read 2 novellas. They're really like novelettes. I think novelettes, correct me if I'm wrong in the comments, but I think that novelettes are shorter than novellas. And this was like a really short free book. It was a bundle deal by Madison Fay. And I found this deal because of Chris, and I'll link her channel down below. She had shared this cover and it was called 15 inches. Excuse me. Okay, it's called 15 inches. You might recognize this cover because the stock photo is for Ice Planet Barbarian. So I'll put that one up right here too. But anyway, 15 inches and Baby It's Cold came as a bundle, free. You can go straight to Madison Fay's website to go select these. Now, I had no prior knowledge. I literally wanted to read it because it says the title is 15 inches, and I knew it was going to be like a smutty kind of like, I wasn't expecting much. I wasn't expecting a lot of depth from these books, but I just want to let you know that this is straight up erotica. There's no like relationship and there's no like HEA at the end. It's just erotica. So the premise of the story is the heroine is doing CrossFit, and there's this CrossFit class that like all the ladies attend because the trainer, the instructor, is very hot and he likes to wear these like tight shorts that like outlines his dick pretty well. You can see everything. And one night after they go next door to get margaritas after doing CrossFit as their reward, she goes back because she forgot her purse in her locker. And so she goes in her locker, but she hears that water's running in the shower area. So she peeks through, and who but her instructor is there in the women's locker room showering, because we come to find out later the men's locker, the showers, something's wrong with them, of course. But he is completely naked and he has a 15-inch dick. And he is stroking that thing. And she is like, oh my God, I can't look away. And it kind of makes things like awkward. She doesn't want to go back to class because she's like, wow, I walked in on him. She does eventually get roped back in going to class because she didn't tell her friends what happened. And they're like, why have you been absent? Come back. So she goes and he talks to her and he's like, I'm really sorry. And like, I didn't think anybody was coming back. The men's showers weren't working and I'm just really sorry. I don't want to make it weird, whatever. So she goes have drinks with her friends, and then she decides, you know what, you only live once. And she tells her friends that she has a scheduled date that she forgot about. She's lying. She goes back to CrossFit and she decides to be a voyeur and watch him. And he is doing the same exact thing. And so they have their very sexy scene. The end. That's the book. I knew it was going to be ridiculous. I still wanted to read it. Sometimes you just want to read those books anyway, even though you know it's not going to give you any like emotional payoff. Sometimes it's just fun to read these. And it is. But let me just tell you, no way would that thing be coming anywhere near me. I'm not interested. That is not my kink. That is not my thing. No. Overly large male penis? No. Mm-mm. Stay away. Thank you. I don't want that. Like, how big is that? Am I gonna have to get out a ruler? I don't want to. Never mind. Let's forget that. Let's move on to the next one. Baby It's Cold by Madison Fay. Oh wait, I didn't even tell you guys what I would rate 15 inches. So I'd rate that 3 stars. Because even though erotica is not my favorite thing, I still do expect like the dialogue and the sex scenes to be like interesting, but I didn't much care for like the dirty talk. I thought it was like cheesy dirty talk. So anyway, 3 stars for that one. It wasn't my fave. Then we have Baby It's Cold. Now, some of you may be familiar with the Christmas song, Baby It's Cold Outside. And I know that a lot of people are like, the song makes me uncomfortable because it just sounds like he's coercing her to stay. And there's been lots of debate on the song. I'm not here to debate it. I'm here to tell you that Madison Faye has taken the sexualization of that song and run with it in this book. So the heroine is a 19 or 20 year old, and she's always had a crush on her older neighbor. He's like as old as her parents, I think. Well, it's almost Christmas and her mom's like, why don't you go bring these cookies over to John, whatever his name is. Things escalate very quickly. And she really leans into the creepiness of that song. I mean, personally, I enjoy Baby It's Cold Outside, but I totally see how it sounds creepy, 100%. And Madison Faye makes it sound creepy because they're actually like saying lines from Baby It's Cold and she's like, I really must go and my mother will be suspicious. Like she literally plays out those lines. Very interestingly, the heroine's like, part of me feels kind of uncomfortable with this situation. So at least Madison Faye acknowledges that one, but I did definitely not like this one. 15 inches, I much preferred that one. This one felt creepy. Leaned in heavily to the creep factor. So 2 stars for Baby It's Cold. So now we get to the part of the weekend where I was in a weird reading mood. I like just didn't know what I wanted to read. I had been listening on audio for the longest time, When the Duke Was Wicked by Lorraine Heath. Like, ooh, this has been on my Kindle for like 2 weeks. My Kindle. I've been listening to this on Audible for like 2 weeks. I listened to like 30 minutes of it and then I'd stop because I wasn't really enjoying it. And I'll let you guys know that this was probably my least favorite Lorraine Heath book that I've read. I did not like it. This was a widower romance and also a childhood crush romance as well. So Grace, the heroine, has always had a crush on the Duke of Lovingdon. They call him Lovingdon all the time, so I'm just gonna call him Lovingdon. Always had a crush on Lovingdon, but Lovingdon married when he was 19. He married very young, and he was in love with his wife, Juliet. She ended up by dying. I forgot what disease was passing through, but he lost his wife and his daughter. And so he's been in major depression for years, and he decides that he doesn't ever want to love again. He's one of those. Now, Grace, she's been pining after him, but also, I really love her backstory because she wants to get married and she wants Lovingdon to help her find the best match for her because she wants to marry somebody who would love her. She has a very big dowry and so she wants to weed out the fortune hunters. And she wants a good marriage. Her parents were very much in love. All of those books, like Lovingdon's parents and Grace's parents, they have books in the Scoundrels of St. James series, I believe. And Grace wants to get married like this. It needs to be now. She's kind of in a hurry because her father is losing his eyesight and she wants to marry before he goes completely blind. And I'm just like, why? Why? So that part was good. But the thing about it is Lovingdon is so woe is me. And I feel so mean saying that, but when I read widow and widower romances, there's a reason why I like them, and some authors really play into the things that I like about that kind of trope, finding a second love. But since Lovingdon was so in love with his wife and was so adamant that he could never let himself love again because losing someone that he loves was too hard, I was very frustrated with him. And I was frustrated with the way that Lorraine Heath chose to play his character because he was so emo about everything. He obviously was jealous. He didn't want Grace to be with any other person. And he was kind of like always like, oh no, not that guy, not that guy. And he would kiss her and be like, oh, I'm just demonstrating. Like this is, if somebody really loved you, like it would be a kiss like this. And she was like, well, why would you kiss me? Like it meant something. And then tell me it was a demonstration. Like, don't do that to me. That hurts me. And so I was very frustrated with Lovingdon's character, especially since, and this is spoilers, especially since at certain points, Lovingdon starts remembering his courtship of Juliet. And he starts to think of them as dull. He's like, yeah, didn't we go on carriage rides? I think we did, but I can't really remember. And like, we never really fought. And it was just, you know, we were a little bit different. And I'm like, wait, this is the relationship, this dull ass relationship that you're describing, that you're remembering, is the one that has brought you to your knees and say, and you have decided you will never love again. It does not compute. He's remembering his relationship with Juliet as very lackluster, but he has twisted it in his mind that he has been so in love with her that nobody could ever compare to Juliet. And I don't like that. And he tells Grace this multiple times. I'll never love anyone like I love Juliet. I'm like, it doesn't match up. Your remembrance of Juliet and what you're telling Grace does not match up, and I don't like it. I don't need an author to erase the first love and be like, oh, well, that wasn't like, he loved her, but like not as much as he loved Grace. I don't need that to happen. He could have loved Juliet and Grace equally, but just in different ways. Kind of like, huh, now that I think of that first relationship, it wasn't that great, and this one's really great. I don't need that. I already like Grace. I don't need Juliet to be like a lesser, paler version of love. So anyway, did not like this book. 3 stars. Then I read Sweatpants Season by Danielle Allen, and this was recommended by Amanda from Talk About Swoon. She did a whole list of book recommendations for the Black Author Readathon, and I was like screenshotting everything. I was like, oh yeah, look at these. And I really picked up Sweatpants Season because of the cover and the title. I mean, gray sweatpants, guys. It's a thing, and I like it. The heroine, Akilah, is taking a photography class because she's a freelance writer, but she wants to up her game, up her website. She's doing everything to like make sure that her brand is like as tight as she can get it to make herself more marketable. For this class, she's going to have a partner for all of her assignments. And she picks Carlos because the girl that she was talking to at first, she's like, this is not gonna work. So she goes sit next to this guy named Carlos, and he looks like he's sleeping. And she's like, okay, he looks like he is just gonna like not argue with me. So we'll do well together because I'll plan everything and he won't get in my way. But Carlos does have opinions and he's extremely attractive. Like, Akilah thought that her teacher, Luca Romano, was very sexy. And he was a big reason why she wanted to take this class as well, because he's hot. But then she sees Carlos and she's like, oh my God, no, this boy is really hot, okay? Like, much more so. Now the conflict comes into play because there's this podcast and it's called The Lost Boys. And it's like a fraternity podcast, and I think they have a new set of people every single year doing the podcast. And this year it's 3 men, and it's City Boy, Country Boy, and Los Carlos. Akilah and her sister and her friend have listened to this podcast, and they're not fans at all because the way that they talk about women, saying that the podcast that we were first listening to, we see the transcript for this podcast. City Boy is talking about how if women wear low-cut shirts, then they're wanting you to look at them, and like it's 100% your right as a man to like ogle them and comment on them and whatever. So we see he's extremely misogynistic, and he gives terrible dating advice, basically terrible dating advice. But we do know that Los is like the voice of reason in this podcast. But understandably, Akilah and her sister and her friend, when she finds out very early on in the class, because Luca's like, oh, I love your podcast, that Carlos, who she has had sparks flying between them, he's very attractive and their banter is pretty good. And now she's very disappointed that he is associated with those people. And she calls his friends trash, and I'm like, yes, they are. So the big conflict, and I'm gonna throw up some spoilers here because, oh, well, I'll rate it first. So I rated this book 3 stars. I didn't really enjoy it from a plot standpoint because it revolves a lot around this podcast and how horrible City Boy and Country Boy are. And the assignment for the she has an assignment because she gets like, it's not an internship, it's a temporary position, and she's going to be researching this single scene in their area, and they're going to be writing 2 separate perspectives. And of course Carlos is involved in this whole situation. I'll talk about that in the spoiler section. But plot wise didn't really enjoy it. Chemistry wise between the characters, I honestly at the end I was like, I don't see these two as being a couple. Okay, so 3 stars. Spoiler time. Akilah tells Carlos off, being like, I don't want to be associated with somebody who is on this podcast that degrades women. He's like, no, it's a conversation, whatever. And we don't encourage men to behave badly when dating women. I'm like, have you listened to your podcast, dude? Have you listened? I know that you're the voice of reason, but do you listen to what City Boy and Country Boy, excuse me, are saying? Do you listen? So there's this thing that happens in this book that they run into each other quite often. So they're in the same photography class. Then she's going to the interview for the job where she ends up by getting the job. And she's sitting in the park, and who shows up but Carlos, and he's in his sweatpants, his gray sweatpants. Okay? They just so happen to run into each other. And she's all like, don't like you, go away. And then she goes into the interview and she gets hired, but they're like, Originally, this position was for one person, but we really think that it would be really cool to do two different perspectives from a man's point of view and a girl's point of view in the single scene. Also, you just so happen to write an article on your blog about his podcast. So Carlos is also working at this job, coincidentally. And I'm just like, it's too much coincidental running into each other where they had never seen each other before. So they go out on a lot of dates, and there's a lot of men approaching Akilah, and they're horrible. There's one guy named Brad who hit on her like a couple weeks ago, and she basically said get lost, and he couldn't take a hint, and he like started calling her bitch and ugly, and she's like, you approached me. What are you talking about? Like, go away. I'm not dealing with this baby man thing that you have going on. They go back to this bar on assignment. The same guy approaches her, does not recognize that he's already approached her. And she makes a comment being like, dude, you've already tried this. Where do you learn your way of dealing with women? Do you listen to the Lost Boys podcast? And he's like, yeah, in fact, I do. Then Carlos comes in, kind of like saves her. They get kicked out and he's like mad about it. Like, you should have not escalated the situation. And she's like, don't blame it on me. His behavior is not on me. And I'm like, yes, girl, yes. It's not on you. And like, Carlos is supposed to be like the enlightened party of the podcast. But sometimes when he says stuff like that, and he wasn't blaming her, but he was just like, I get it. He was being a dick, but like, you escalated it. And she was just like, I'm gonna stand up for myself. And I get it, we're on a job, but also this is ridiculous. Like, he was being awful. In subsequent episodes of the podcast, because she does write an article and she name drops the podcast being like, this guy approached me, and guess who he listens to? The Lost Boys. So they're encouraging men to approach women and not take no for an answer. And I'm like, yeah, they are. He feels comfortable because this podcast is very popular. So the Lost Boys bring up the article and they're like, listeners, what do you think of this? And so the listeners are calling in and like, I think she's a stuck up spinster bitch. I think she's ugly as fuck and stuff like that. And City Boy's like, yeah, yeah, like encouraging all of this. And there's this one scene where I was like, this is so horrible. And like, I know that there are guys like this out there, but it was just so depressing that this podcast and what awful things that these guys are saying was such a big part of the book, because it really overshadowed the romance with Carlos. And the fact that he was associated with these people really turned me off, like a lot. Like, he was cool, but like, the fact that he had blinders on for so long in this book really turned me off, because there's just one scene where this caller called in and been like, what she really needs is like a good, somebody needs to dick her down and like, I'll like hold her down and I'll force her. Basically insinuating that he would rape her, Akilah, to show her who's boss and show her what a real man does. And like, City Boy's like, ha ha ha. And Carlos speaks up during the podcast being like, excuse me, like, no, like, that is completely wrong. Do not do that, whatever. But he's still in the position where like, you know, City Boy and Country Boy, I forgot what their real names are, who cares? They really don't mean anything by it. They're not really encouraging. Like, I've known them forever. And I'm just like, if these are your friends, you've been knowing them since you were 18, these are the people that you hang out with, it just does not speak well of you. And Akilah brings this up to him multiple times. And he's just like, I don't see it. And I'm like, Carlos, work with me. So anyway, there comes a point where City Boy takes it too far, uploads a picture of her sister, thinking that it's Akilah's breast, because he was just like, let's objectify them, the fun bags. Akilah tells Carlos he did it on purpose. And Carlos is like, no, he probably didn't know that that was your sister. It's just a coincidence. And she's like, I'm telling you that he absolutely did it on purpose. We know that she overheard him actually saying this, City Boy, because she goes on the podcast. It's a whole thing. It's horrible. And Carlos doesn't believe her. And at this point, I'm done with Carlos. I'm like, don't waste your time on him. And then Danielle Allen tries to wrap it up in the end, saying like, oh, well, you know, he does eventually quit the podcast on air. And then Akilah's like, oh, well, you know, I really do have a connection with him. And I'm like, no. Don't like it. So anyway, that's my spoiler review of that. I did not enjoy this book at all. Then I reread Love is a Rogue by Lenore Bell for the podcast. We recorded our episode on it. I love this. This is kind of like Beauty and the Beast-esque but the heroine's nickname is Beastly Beatrice. And the reason why she's called Beastly Beatrice, it's a horrible nickname that people have bestowed upon her. It's not a huge part of the story though, is because when she was born, they had to use forceps on her and she has nerve damage to her face. And so it's a little bit droopy. I love how it's not like, it has not defined her, not really. She has a very large dowry, but she just doesn't want to mess with society. She prefers books. She loves words. She loves etymology. And her dream is to write an etymological dictionary. And she wants to stay in the country estate of her brother, who is the Duke of Thorndon. And her brother's like, yeah, you can stay with me forever. And so while her mother's trying to matchmake her during the London season, she's just like, no, I'm like comfortable in my spinsterhood, and kind of like botches all like her plan, her mother's plans for her. But the first chapter of this book introduces the hero. His name is Stanford Wright, and they have the most hilarious scene, and it is beautiful. It's one of my favorite scenes of the entire book. Beatrice is trying to do her etymology. She's writing down words, and she's distracted because outside of the window, she hears giggles and laughter and male voices and hammering because there are some renovations being done on her brother's estate. And Stanford Wright is taking the place of his father because his father's ill. And she is very frustrated because Stanford is very charming. He's very flirty, and like all the housemaids want to like bring him drinks and stuff. And so it's like she writes his name and she's like, Stanford Wright, C. Rogue. And she writes what she thinks about him, like as a dictionary entry. It's very funny. Well, she decides to spy on Stanford because things get kind of quiet. She hears like some smacking sound. She's like, oh my god, is he making out with a maid or something? Leans over and her spectacles fall out, and she's like, oh no, now he knows I'm spying on. He climbs the trellis to give her back her glasses, and they have the most amazing banter. It's awesome. Anyway, you should read this book. Our podcast is coming out next week. 4.5 stars, rounded up to 5 stars because the ending, I had some issues with that. But anyway, then I reread Until November by Aurora Rose Reynolds. I don't know why I felt the need to reread this. I was looking through one of my collections, which is paid TBR. And for some reason, those books were still in my paid TBR, but I had already read them. And like, this is like an unread collection. And I was like, oh, I haven't read this in like 3 years. Let's read it. And I reread it. And I remember I was like, that was an okay book. I remember the first time that I read it, I was like, this is okay. Pretty low conflict with the relationship romance. Let's try it out again. I read this book and I hated the heroine and I hated the hero and I hated their relationship. So upon reread, I have docked stars. I don't even know what I originally rated this book, but it is just not great. The heroine, if you would take a shot for every time she says, rolls her eyes or says whatever, you'd be comatose within the first chapter. I like the second chapter. But she really has no personality. The guy is very overbearing. This is supposed to be like, oh my god, love at first sight. He knows that they should be together. And basically he strong arms her into a relationship. And it's supposed to be cute, but I didn't think it was cute. Maybe I thought it was like semi-okay the first time that I read it. But honestly, he was a big turnoff. She couldn't do anything without like his permission. It was just weird. Anyway, so that was my reading week. And it was okay, but I don't feel like I'm in a book slump because I have so many books that I want to read and I'm excited to read. So I just don't feel slumpy, even though I didn't have the best reading week. So that's a good sign. All right, guys, that is it for this weekly wrap up. I will see you again next week, and there's going to be some exciting books for next week. Will I be able, you know, maybe that? Anyway, you'll find out. Just tune in. If you like this video, give it a big thumbs up. And if you're not already subscribed to my channel, make sure that you subscribe to get notified on any future videos that I do. Thank you so much for watching. And remember, life's better with a little HEA. Bye, guys.